listening to Nasty Knuckles, the Hockey Outlaws podcast, with your hosts, Derek Nasty Settlemyre and former Philadelphia Flyer enforcer, Riley Cote, as they go behind the scenes with your favorite NHL players. This week's guest is highly skilled Flyers defenseman, the Russian Bear, Ivan Provorov. Time to face off.
Welcome back to Nasty Knuckles. I'm Riley Cote.
I'm Derek Settlemyre. Welcome. We have a great guest today. One of my favorite players in the league, the Russian Bear, Ivan Provorov. Thanks for coming, buddy.
Thanks for having me.
Right, man.
Appreciate you coming by.
No, of course.
Provy, I'm going to start with this. You grow up, obviously, you're from Russia. You moved over here at an early age, 13 or 14 years old. Tell us a little bit about that, because that's got to be tough when you're that age, leaving your country, your language, everything like that.
Yeah, definitely. My first tournament was actually in November. I was 13. We had a little bit of a break from school, and usually we have tournaments at home at that time when we have a week or a 2 week break from school, but we didn't. So my dad and I decided to come over here for a tournament and, you know, try it out. It's kind of was through a friend. Yeah, I came over to Wilkes-Barre, went to the Chicago Nike Bauer tournament. We won, loved my experience, and ever since, you know, my dad and I kind of talked about it and said, like, yeah, this is the route we want to take. Because at that point, I kind of sort of, the hockey at home just, I kind of like, I don't know, I would say overgrew, or however you would say that. So I needed something, you know, more challenging, something new. Plus, you know, from day one, I knew I wanted to play in the NHL. So my dad and I knew that, you know, the earlier I can come, the faster I can adjust, you know, to the culture, to the language and everything like that. So when I get to the NHL, hopefully at that time I was thinking like that, I wouldn't spend any time, you know, adjusting to the lifestyle or the people, the language, the coaching and everything like that. So, and yeah, spent my first 2 years in Wilkes-Barre, playing for the Wilkes-Barre Junior Knights, you know, awesome experience, awesome people. We played pretty much an NHL schedule. My first year, we played 100 games. My second year, we played 92 games.
Wow, you know, incredible.
My first year, Bantam year, we won nationals. We only lost 4 games all year, seven ties, and then whatever the rest of them were wins. And then second year was midget U16. Same thing, won our league, lost in the semis at national, but still another great year. Lots of games, lots of experience, good experiences. And then third year was, you know, Cedar Rapids. First year kind of away from, you know, away from the Russian people, I guess, because in Wilkes-Barre, we had a Russian coach. I had a few Russian teammates. And there was, you know, 16, going to play my first year of junior hockey, kind of away from everyone. You know, my parents weren't able to come to visit me that often, but it was another great experience. Overall, I got really lucky with the, you know, with the teams and the coaches and all the billet families that I stayed with that, you know, made the experience real fun and real easy. Yeah, just, and then after a year in Cedar Rapids, spent 2 years in Brandon, Manitoba.
There you go. Yeah.
Really, really cold, freezing. Even, you know, being from Russia, being used to the cold, it still was very, very, very cold.
It's a special place.
And then the 2 years there were unbelievable. You know, my first year, we won the league, lost in the finals to a very stacked Kelowna team. You know, got drafted. After that, went back for another year. And then after that, we were able to, you know, win the championship, and, you know, have another great year, successful year. And it was just ton of fun, just, you know, hanging out with the boys, playing hockey, and, you know, just hanging out.
Yeah.
Awesome.
It's awesome. And I couldn't imagine being 13. And I know, Riles, when you were younger, you went and played junior hockey. So it's something I never, you know, I'd go away for camp.
Summer camp for a week.
And I'm like, kind of miss my mom a little bit. But you're, you know, you're moving all the way over here. And it's, and knowing you as well as I do, I mean, it doesn't surprise me now knowing you and your work ethic and all of that. But you put all that work in coming over, pick 7th overall. I mean, that had to be a dream come true, obviously.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, like I said, from, you know, very young age, all I wanted to do is to play in the NHL. You know, and when I was 13 coming over here, it was definitely hard at first, you know, to be away from my family and, you know, friends and adjusting. You know, it wasn't easy, but like I said, people around me made it easy for me and made me comfortable. And then just, you know, overall, I had, you know, one goal in mind and, you know, I wanted to do whatever, you know, it took to get here.
Yeah. Well, you did that.
Yeah. You definitely made the right choice. You know, 13 years old, it's a tough decision. And outside of the language and the culture adjustments, what was the biggest adjustment hockey wise for you coming from Russian hockey culture to, you know, North American hockey culture?
I think just the ice surface, you know, it's smaller, less time. And I think just the, you know, players' mentality here is a little bit more north-south. At home, it's a lot of east-west possession. Here is more kind of putting the puck to the net, you know, getting aggressive, you know, shooting from everywhere. So my first 2 years in Wilkes-Barre, I kind of, we had a little bit of a hybrid, a mixed between European hockey and North American, because we did have, you know, a lot of players from Europe and then from Canada, and just overall, you know, our coach was from Russia. So we did play a little bit of a different type of hockey, but then I, you know, I got the full experience of it when I got to USHL and, you know, there it's kind of, you know, very up and down hockey, really defensive and, you know, really fast and physical.
Yeah. And then getting in the Western Hockey League is the same, more of the same, right?
Yeah. And then more structure. I think it was still very structured, physical, and then definitely more skilled than people, you know, give credit to, to the WHL.
Yeah. Especially nowadays, right? I mean, it's no longer the old WHL where it was meathead stew. But no, it's interesting your progression. And I'm curious about your training. You know, I always like to explore a different people's philosophy when, you know, it comes to training. And obviously I think Europeans, specifically Russians, seem to have, I say a different philosophy. I think they're more progressive. I don't know. They seem like they're 5 or 10 years ahead a lot of times. And you take pride in that. You're big into the overall strength and conditioning game, fitness, the whole bit. Maybe talk to that and maybe philosophy differences and some of the stuff you've carried over into North America.
Yeah. I would say from a really, you know, young age, my dad, you know, kind of taught me that, you know, nothing can beat the hard work. You know, you can be, you know, as talented as you can be, but if you don't work hard, you're not going to get anywhere. So, you know, from a very young age, he took me to different practices, boxing, track and field, a bunch of stuff. So, you know, to become more a well-rounded athlete, kind of well-balanced, you know, player. And, you know, now every summer I go home, you know, I train with all my coaches that I've, you know, 5 or 6 of them that I've known from, you know, since I was 8, 9 years old. And yeah, every summer we get together, they make a program for me. And then for 2 months, 2.5 months, depending on how much time I have, you know, for that time, I just, you know, eat, sleep and train, you know, three, four practices a day, kind of doing, you know, whatever I can to prepare for the season. So I have, you know, kind of enough strength and enough juice to kind of last me all year. So I don't need, sometimes like if I didn't want to, I don't even have to go in the gym. I have enough energy and juice to kind of get me through the year and the playoffs, you know. So, and, you know, with that training, it just allows me to kind of during the year maintain my strength with just small bands, small weights, stuff like that. Because a lot of times when you play hockey and then you lift heavy, it kind of makes you stiff.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, I hate that feeling. So I don't want to ever feel like that. So I put a lot of work in the summer so I don't have to lift heavy and feel stiff ever in the season.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. And the philosophy of building all-around athletes, I think, is transferring more to North American culture as far as, you know, specifically for hockey training. Because I know, like, when I grew up, it was like you're all in on hockey. You pick a sport and you're all in. But I think the wiser way of doing it is to build an overall sound athlete. You know what I mean? Like, you do sprints, you play other sports, you're more functional. And then in turn, you become a better athlete. I think it's becoming more of a thing in the Western culture here, which is...
Yeah, definitely. I think, you know, overall, just at home, you know, they used to, you know, lock people in, you know, in the training facilities, and they would go through a full-on training camp. I think here was a little bit more of kind of people, you know, doing their stuff on their own.
Yeah.
So I think that's why a lot of times, you know, a lot of European players, you know, come in really good, great shape. But I think now it's all over the place. You know, people want to get better. People find different ways to challenge themselves. And you know, you see there's so many players from all over the world now that come out and, you know, being picked in the first round and playing in the NHL.
I know, like, even like, you know, when I was still playing in like that old school mentality of like, you know, go hard, like off the ice. And, you know, there's so much training and you're slowing down your fast twitch muscles because you're probably lifting too much throughout the week. Like, I feel like you're light years ahead of, you know, younger guys because of that, because it's hard to break that mold of thinking that you have to do all this lifting and all this extra grunt work and then play 82 games. That's probably the reason why you played 82 games for 3 seasons in a row, all the games in the regular season. And I think without COVID, you probably would have played 82 games again this year. You know, it's prevention of injury, right? You're trying to sustain you know, the season and stay healthy, right? I mean, it's got to be, you know, a connection between
training. I think, you know, you have to put the time in, you have to put the work in, you have to love it, you have to take care of your body to be able to, you know, play all 82 games. And then, you know, if you do that, that will help you, you know, to play longer, to play better. You know, like I said, having a really great summer of hard work, when you build enough strength and juice for the season, that, you know, you don't need to lift.
That's it.
You can just maintain it. That way it's, you can focus on hockey and, you know, try to play your best, you know. But if you didn't have that great of a summer, you know, you had one workout and then you went and golfed, just, you know,
right,
that's not really summer training.
Yeah.
So you, then you have to, you know, compensate during the season. You have to find time to like lift heavy so you can, you know, kind of maintain and kind of almost like catch up every
right.
time to, you know, to the your best shape. And then, yeah, that's when people kind of start having like rocky seasons. You know, they
yeah.
feel good for 3 weeks, then they fall off for 2 weeks. But if you, you know, have a strong base and, you know, a lot of work is put in the summer, you can go through the whole season like this.
Yeah. It's good insight.
Yeah, being around you, well, for one, I'm so jacked, I don't really have to do that so much, but
just naturally.
Just naturally. Yeah, I wish. But honestly, being around you, you know, the last 4.5 years, Riley, you worked hard. You're a hardworking guy.
I didn't work smart, though, and that's what it's fascinating
well, and
about.
He's, I've never seen anyone put that work in. I know one thing, like you're talking about playing other sports. Freddie Couples here. Picked up golf about 6 weeks ago, shooting 85 now.
No big deal.
Yeah, but he loves basketball. He's a big basketball guy. He's a goon. He should have played for the Pistons when they're the bad boys. He's like Bill Laimbeer out there throwing.
Yeah, elbows. Yeah.
Hey, you got to play hard.
Yeah, I got great space, man.
We were playing. We used to goof around and play and hit the rink and stuff. And we're playing 1-on-1. And he's so competitive, obviously. He's so fast, too. This big man is like, I can't believe how fast he is. I'm like, you know, I still got, I'm only 35, right, boys?
Yeah, right, yeah.
Something like that. Anyway, so anyway, I think I got him with a move. I'm going, next thing I know, he's right in front of me, and my chin, right into his shoulder, I'm seeing stars.
Wow.
I'm like, I'm conky, you know, I'm like, goon, man. But But anyway, this guy, like, he's been playing a lot of golf. Why don't you tell us how you kind of got into that?
Honestly, just, you know, decided to get the clubs, you know, or right before we went for the bubble, and they actually came two days before yeah. we left.
So, well, you had one set come, but they were wrong hand. Dummy here.
This guy.
He ordered my dad's.
Still
Taylor
probably
made
a better golfer than myself.
So I order the clubs, and my old man says, oh, lefty or righty? Yeah, righty. Yeah, no big deal. They come. He's a lefty.
Oh, yeah.
So then we had to wait a little bit longer. But anyway,
Then they came in, whatever, two days before we went for the bubble. Didn't really get to try them. We went to Top Golf, but it was like,
not quite the same.
Can't really test it out. So whatever, we came back from the bubble. All the boys were gone, and I'm here. And I was like, all right. And I was itching to play a little bit. So as soon as we got home, yeah, I was like, let's go. So from that time, for 4 weeks straight, almost, we were going 3-4 times a week. You know, went a few times to the driving range. I just bought a bunch of stuff for swing tracker.
He's got
everything you can possibly think. Well,
you're all in.
I'm the guy that I hate doing bad at something. So
yeah, right.
Even if, you know, if I start doing something, I have to do good just right. for myself.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, right. Yeah.
We were playing a couple weeks ago over here, of course, close by. I think you parred the first three holes.
Yeah.
This guy just started playing golf. He pars the first three holes, which I'm three shots behind already.
Yeah.
And pissed off. So we get to the fourth hole. He hits his drive, whatever. And it's like, he didn't hit it right down the middle. It's kind of off to this. I'm done. I'm like, he's just so competitive. I'm like, what do you mean you're done? You're even right now.
Yeah,
the
right?
fourth hole, you hit one bad shot. But I wish I could do that with golf. He goes to the driving range. He does everything, and it kind of comes back full circle to his hockey.
Right,
to
yeah.
The way you prepare.
It's committed.
Train.
It's commitment, right?
It's actually amazing. But one of the things I know you kind of laugh about, we talked about the other day, was this poll came out last week about the top 25
I saw that,
in
yeah.
the league. And I honestly didn't see it right away, and my dad messaged me. Actually, called me, and he was losing his mind. I go, who's making these things up? Provy wasn't on there.
Who actually published that?
I don't even know.
That?
ESPN? I don't know who it was.
The NHL Network.
NHL Network or something? So what I thought was great was Claude Giroux sent a tweet out.
I saw that.
And then I saw that once my dad had called, and I looked at it, and I was like, well, I'm glad Claude did that, because obviously he knows, he sees you every day for the last 4 years. But you don't really have to say too much about it, but I can say what a joke.
Yeah, it
that
is a
was.
Joke.
I mean,
yeah.
It's not even, I can't even understand what they're looking at, but I know you, I know your mentality. You don't really care. You just want to play. You know who you are, what you are, but did you kind of get a chuckle out of it at least?
Yeah, a little bit. I mean, honestly, I don't care, you know, which list I make, which list I don't make. Personally, I know where I stand and, you know, where I am right now in my career and what level I am right now at. So, I mean, honestly, you know, if they don't put me on some sort of list, I'm going to sleep just as good.
Yeah.
You know,
I know
this night or the next night. So, I mean, that doesn't change the way I think, the way I play or, you know, go about my business.
Yeah. Right. That being said, like, do you feel like, you know, like listening to you talk about how dialed in you are with your routine and everything like that, like, how many more like dimensions you have yet? You're only, what, 23 years old, 4 years in the league. I mean, you have so many more great years. I mean, I don't even think you've like scratched the surface of what you can really do in this league.
Yeah. I mean, like, I always want to get better. I think there is no, you know, there's no limits. There's always room for improvement. So, you know, great players like Lindstrom, Datsuk, those guys always found a way to get better.
Right.
That's what I want to do. I try to do that every day. And, you know, I'm going to continue to do that. I'm going to continue to, you know, play the way I play and try to, you know, put up, you know, better stats and just overall play better with every game. And, you know, hopefully, you know, we're going to be able to put, you know, a few winning seasons together and, you know, be able to go real far in the playoffs. And, you know, when you do that, you know, overall, your team success, everyone has success, and right. you know, your personal success, you have that too.
Yeah.
Another thing about your game, Provy, is that you play 25 minutes a night, basically, yeah. 24 and change, but close to 25. And we would always joke about, like, this guy'd come back to the bench, he'd be on the ice, you know. He plays all the important minutes. You know, he's penalty killing, power play, everything else, against the top line every night. People don't realize that sometimes, as you know, Riley, like watching hockey, but he wants to play 40 minutes a night.
Oh, yeah.
And you probably could. Yeah. I really believe that. But he would come back to the bench after a shift and, like, take about 10 seconds to get your breath in, and you're like, kind of like
looking back.
Am I up?
Oh, they're going up. Oh.
Yeah,
no,
yeah,
I'm right. kidding. But, you know, it's just so funny. After a game, I'm like, ah, you're pretty tired. No, I'm going to go in here and work out for a little bit. And that goes back to, you know, your training, like you said, not to, you know, go all the way back to that again. But it's funny.
I think overall, I just, you know, I love to compete, yeah. you know, and I truly enjoy both sides of the puck, you know, playing against the top lines. You know, you get to shut them down. You get to see the frustrating looks on their faces, them slamming their sticks. You know, there's even penalty kill, you know, being able to, you know, keep, you know, the other team without shots or any shooting lanes, you know, when, say, the other team dumps the puck in and you're able to get out of the pressure clean with a little pop to the middle when you have two guys on you. That's, you know, when you get to this level, you enjoy those things. And then, you know, offensive part is, you know, always fun.
That's
you know,
fun
trying
part.
To create something on the power play when you get into the zone, or, you know, make a sick pass, or, you know, find a lane and, you know, score through traffic or something like
right.
that. You know, that's everyone knows that's fun, but a lot of people don't know that, you know, defense can be fun too. And, you know, being able to shut down, you know, the other teams is a lot more enjoyable than people think it is. So, and I think overall, I just want to be out there, you know, as much as possible to help the team win, because I think I hate losing more than I like winning.
Yeah.
So that's why I just want to be out there as much as I can and, you know, stay on the ice as long as I can.
Yeah.
Yeah. Makes sense. Your attitude is so perfect for being an athlete. I mean, you're hungry, you're committed. You're critical of yourself, and you're honest about yourself as well. Like, I mean, if you could pick apart your game and be, you know, critical of one area that you'd like to improve, what would that be?
I think I'm pretty well-rounded.
Yeah.
I think, like I said before, but there's always room to improve.
Yeah.
Like, I still want to, you know, be able to be better defensively, be able to be better on, you know, power play, on penalty kill, and just overall, and any area of my game that I can improve on or I can think of, I want to improve and I want to get better. And, you know, that's what I'm going to continue to do. But I think overall, you know, I think I pride myself on being very well-rounded.
Yeah.
So I think, like, if you had to pick one, I couldn't really tell you, you know, which
yeah.
one. But I think overall, like I said, I want to get better and I will continue to do that.
Yeah.
Sure.
No, it makes a ton of sense. I was just thinking if there was like a little thing like,
I think maybe
like passing
just,
or shooting versus shooting is like,
I think
you're a little bit of a hybrid of
maybe
both.
Maybe more of, I'm almost being, try to be too perfect, you know?
Right.
You know, just, you know, I always want to play, you know, a perfect game. You
right.
know, sometimes it's hard to do. Sometimes it happens only like a few times, you know, a year. But mentally, sometimes it's almost not as satisfying, you know, if you had a good game, but you thought you could have played great.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think other than that, I think, yeah, that's, I think my biggest thing is sometimes even just, a great good games happen.
Yeah.
But I personally, I always want to play great
yeah,
and,
yeah.
you know, do everything that I can, you know, like I said, to help the team win.
Yeah. Just letting it be and being satisfied
yeah.
with a good game
yeah.
and not having a great game every single
yeah.
game. Yeah. That's pretty impressive.
The one of the things I wanted to ask you, Provy, which I kind of know being around you for 4 years as your equipment guy, superstitions. Do you feel like you're a superstitious guy? Because I know
no.
You tell you
not at all.
No.
Not at all.
Not at all. I'm kidding. I am. I am very superstitious. I mean, every time I get to the rink for game time, I do exactly the same routine every time. From changing to taping my sticks to warming up to going through all the meetings. To then, after some meetings, go try to stick handle, and then I would always call his name and yell and try to find him. And of course, every time I, the time for me to, stick handle is he'll be either fixing something or not in his usual space in the room. So I'd be like walking around trying to find him and be like, Nast, where are you? And he'd be like, I'm coming. And then, when it gets to the ice, my whole warm-up routine, I guess the whole warm-up, I skate in the same pattern every warm-up. I do the same thing. I do good, get on the ice, do two laps, and then I come to the red line, stick handle. Then we get into a three-lane shooting and goes on and on and on.
He does the exact same thing.
Exactly the same thing.
It's funny, right away when he was, you were really quiet. I mean, you're not like a crazy loud guy anyway, but he was super, super quiet, his first year. And I mean, he talked, but it was usually to me. Yeah. It was usually in my office. Right, we'd sit there and we'd talk and stuff. But it was funny. We got into this thing to where I had one of Patrick Kane's sticks, and I forget how we ended up with it.
It was last year. We were playing in Czech Republic.
That's right.
You got one of his sticks from when we were there. And then the home opener this past season, we were playing against Jersey, and that stick was whatever, standing there.
Yeah.
So I grabbed it, I stick handled it for a bit. And then whatever, we went on and we ended up winning 4-0, and I scored the first goal.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, damn, I got
to go back. So I had to carry this thing on the road.
I got to do this. I got to do this again. So whatever, we kept doing it for a while. And, the team was playing well. I was playing well personally, putting up numbers that I liked. So I was like, I got to continue to do this. And then I think one of the road trips, I think we forgot it or something. So we had to send it.
Yeah. That's right.
I was like, we gotta get it.
That stick. But it was funny because I tried to be paying attention to when he was coming, but there's a million things going on. Yeah. And me, I'm so hyper. One of their equipment guys would come down, or a player from the other team wanted to say hi. So I'd run out. And I always have my phone in my back pocket. I'd be in mid-conversation and my phone would ring. And I'd be like, oh, shit. And they're like, what? I got to go. And they're like, what? I said, Provy needs me. Yeah. And I look out and it's Provy. Yeah.
Where's my Patrick Kane stick?
And I'd grab the puck. And what we'd do is I'd throw him the puck. He'd catch it, flip it, and then he'd start stick handling. Okay. And then he had to give it back to me. So I had to stand there and wait.
Yeah.
If I leave, you're
anti pants.
He's got his times that he's got to do his stuff. And it's just so funny because people would be like, where are you going? We're mid conversation. I'm sprinting. I'm like, Provy. Yeah. And I'd walk in there. But anyway, that stuff's fun. And you've got one. I guess it's a superstition, but he ties his skates. He actually don't tie them as tight as he used to.
No.
But he would sweat tying his skates. And it just almost made me anxious watching him tie his skates because he'd do it.
Works so
he
wore
gloves for a while because he's ripping his hands apart. But anyway, so he always leaves them tied because he ties them and that's it. But his tape, he's got this perfect tape job, right?
Yeah.
So during a period, probably 3 to 4, could be 6 times, just depending on the game, he'd get a little cut from either a skate, the puck, and he'd be like, nah, hold a stick back. So I always had this little knife and I'd cut the little tape off.
Oh, yeah.
And
a little surgery.
And people kind of looking at me. I'm like, it's a little surge. I'm feeling good. If he scores, it's because I cut his tape.
Assist on it.
Kidding. But it's funny because I remember one time a couple of years ago, I said, why don't you just tape him like in between periods? I can't.
No,
because he's got, well, he's got,
no, got three other, four other things.
No, because
to do.
You have a lot of stuff.
It's just, honestly, it takes so much energy to tape this thing.
And plus, is that
I'm,
perfect?
No, I'm like I said, I'm such a perfectionist. So it does take me a little longer
right.
than say like most of the guys.
Yeah.
So plus when I, you know, come off the ice, I gotta, you know, you whatever, you either go to the bathroom, you go get whatever electrolytes, the hydration drinks, and then I always go to check my blades. And so by the time, you know, it's like 5 minutes are gone.
Yeah.
And then in whatever, in a minute or two, the coaches come in to talk to us. So you really kind of don't have enough time.
Yes.
And
unless you're G getting dressed.
Well,
in a minute and 20 seconds.
That guy
seconds.
Gets dressed in like under 2 minutes. And
he's
then,
like Richie.
He gears to totally do. Down, eh?
Totally down. But he comes in before warm-ups and everyone's in the hallway. The only guy standing there is
I'm like dressed 14 minutes before warm-up.
Yeah.
And then he comes in like with 4 minutes before we have to go on the ice, throws his gear on in 2 minutes.
It's like faster than Richie.
Tapes his stick in like 5 seconds. And I was like, holy.
Yeah.
I would have the biggest anxiety.
Yeah. You and me both.
Provy, so the one day, you know, like, obviously I didn't mind doing it. I always just waiting for him to hold it and I would do it. But I said to one day, like, you know, why don't you tape? And he's like, I can't. It's too much going on. I said, okay. I said, well, I'll tape for it. No. I didn't even get it out of my mouth. He's no. I don't want you to.
No, of course not.
I know why.
It's honestly like, you know, you get used to the same tape job and then the puck starts feeling the same on your stick every time.
Oh, yeah.
But if you start like playing with your tape job, then the puck will feel a little bit off on your stick. So, and I'm the guy that noticed the very little details.
Yes. Yes.
Like stick, if the stick is, you know, different weight than normal, I would feel that. If my,
it's like Gagne.
You wouldn't have loved my tape job.
You would not.
You would have done so well.
If my blades are a little slippery, I'll have to change them. Or even I have the tiny snick, I would feel it skating. So I would, like the one time when we were playing in Dallas, I switched my blades 11 times.
Wow.
He did.
Luckily, we had 12 to 15 pairs.
He has. I always made every other player when I was there on the team had 6 sets because, you know, you change them. That way you're not running back to the room having to sharpen, come back, you know, you're missing. He would come off the ice. And that's another thing I really always appreciated about you is it's hard when you're in a hockey game, Riles, you know, like got your intensities there. Maybe something didn't go your way. He's like, Nas, could you please check the outside right? You know, I'm just like, I love this kid. You know, his first year, everything's please and thank you. And it's hard to do. You don't really expect that, but it's always a nice thing. And that's Provy. It's just the person he is. But anyway, he'd come back and he'd be like, Nas, right side back edge. And I would look and it would be something like this big. And I'm like, yeah, you got a little nick there. So this is like the first couple times. So you go back on the ice, no problem. He trusts me. He goes out and he wasn't slippery, but he knew in his mind that it was there.
Yeah.
So he'd come back. He'd be like, I think we could change those. I'm like, yeah, of course. So then when he would come and be like, hey, middle, outside, you know, and I'd be like, just give me your foot. I'm changing it. Cause you know, he likes mentally knowing that there's, and I don't blame him because if you go out there and there is something.
Oh, yeah.
And he's got to jump.
Oh, especially you know, like, you know, being the D, some, a lot of times you're the last guy. So, you know, if you wipe out,
For sure. How many times have you seen that happen in real games?
100%.
So I'd rather be, you know, safe than sorry.
For sure.
Yeah. And, you know, it wasn't like it was any sort of pain. It was just, I was more amazed that he could actually feel such a small nick and exactly where it was. Like, I didn't even have to look because he'd be like inside right of the toe, outside left. And I'm just like, how the hell does he feel? And I would always equate it to Gagne with the stick being an ounce like heavier.
Yeah.
And he'd be like, this one's no good. I'm like, gags.
The same bash too. Hey?
And he's like that too.
Yeah.
And, but we would send him back and they were like, he's right. They were like 0.1 off.
That's being in tune. That's why these guys are high end pros.
I know,
man.
I know. And, you know, I used to kind of laugh at gags and, but he was dead on every time. He was never wrong about that.
That's
and even Provy can pick a stick up and do it too. So, but it's like you said, they're high end players and they take it serious and
it's just, honestly, everyone's so different, you know, in their pregame routine. Some guys don't have it at all. Some guys, you know, like the particular stuff. Some guys don't care at all and could use a different, you know, have a different tape job, different stick, different gloves, and wouldn't even notice it. But,
right.
You know, everyone's different and everyone's so unique in their own way. So,
yeah. I know one thing I wanted to ask, and it kind of sucks, but I guess we're happy for him, is Matt Niskanen retiring, which no one expected. You guys just seemed to have a chemistry right away at the beginning of the year. And just, you know, I think he's more one of those underrated type of players. Like, he's not a flashy guy. I almost call him kind of old school, because he played pretty hard, man. And he had an edge to him. And I thought it was a great fit for you. I know you love Niski, but, you know, what do you think about that?
I mean, definitely, you know, sad to see, you know, him, you know, retiring, just because, you know, never going to be able to play with him again. But I think, you know, overall, I'm happy for him. And, you know, if he's happy with his decision, then, I'm all for it. I'm happy for him and, you know, his family. Overall, he's just, you know, a great player and even better human being.
Yeah.
And then on the ice, you know, super well-rounded. You know, very steady, you know, steady Eddie.
Yeah.
You know, just, you know, he's able to do it all, you know, break out, you know, PK, power play, you know, and then we did have a, you know, good chemistry right off the start, and it was, you know, easy playing with him. You know, we were able to talk some things out. You know, if something didn't go, you know, our way, we would get together and talk and say, hey, I think next time we should do this and that, you know, and, you know, he was very open and, you know, and it was awesome, you know, and overall, I think, you know, just with me and him having a good chemistry, it was so easy to get out of their zone. And then, you know, on the offensive side, we could create and, you know, help the team that way too.
Yeah. Yeah. He was, I always liked him as a player. I got to know him a little bit at the World Cup with Team USA and everything. He used to make me laugh, though. So last year when we ended up getting him, he's one of those guys, Riles, where you're texting him, and you know me, like, I'm blabbermouth and I'm hyper. So I'm sending this long text asking him all these questions. So let me know what you think. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, what?
Yeah.
I asked you about 10 things in this. Do you want me to call you? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I call him. Human. I get a few more words out of him anyway, but he was always like that. But, like, I know he'll be missed, man. But I'm happy, like you said, I'm happy for him. That's what he wanted to do. But I feel like it's going to be tough filling that void. I'm sure they will. I'm sure they'll figure out.
I know still owe Niski an apology for that flying elbow I threw against Dallas back in the day.
That's true.
Three-game suspension.
Yeah, I forgot about that. Oh, my God.
I feel bad.
Niski, I made it over to his house right before you guys left for the bubble. Went over and had a couple waters with him. And we were talking, and he started telling the story about, were you here when him and Lotz, was that your rookie year or maybe before you?
It was the year before.
Okay.
In the playoffs when they played the Wash and Philly series.
Yes.
That was the year I got drafted, but I didn't make the team as an 18-year-old. Okay.
So anyway, long story short, Niski caught Scott Lawton with his head down, conky. So we come back to play him. And Niski's like talking about, we were talking about Chief last week, being able to sleep. Niski's like, all I can think of is Wayne Simmonds is coming for me because of that hit on Lawton. Even though it was clean, it was a clean hit, but Niski's old school. Hey, like I got to answer the bell. Thank God, being an equipment guy, I never had to answer any bells like that, because I don't know how you guys do it. But anyway, Niski's like, all I can think of is, oh my God, I got to fight Wayne Simmonds tonight. This is not going to go well, you know? Like, so he get in the game. Well, Lotz goes right up to him and says, hey, let's go. And Niski goes, all I could think was, thank God. And he's like, nothing against Lotz, but that last thing I wanted to do was have to fight Wayne. But I love Niski, man, and I wish him all the best. He was great. It was fun watching you guys play together. He's such a competitor. Speaking of hits and Simmonds, Wayne Simmonds.
The amount of time that guy saved me from getting jumped or fighting is
Well,
too many to count.
So we're playing Riles in, I think it was 2017. We're in Nashville.
It was the New Year's Eve 2017, 2018.
Okay. So we're playing and Provy catches Fiala coming into the zone. And I mean, absolutely just bulldozes him. But the funny part is Provy hits him, kind of turns. Well, Simmer's going to change. Well, he sees the hit kind of out of the corner of his eye. And I pulled this video up to watch it.
And then there's like, I hit him. I turn around. As soon as I hit him, I knew.
You knew
like,
someone's coming.
He's almost like this. Probably like, who's coming?
Hey, who's coming?
There's like three guys were heading my way.
And Simmer sees it.
Oh.
And he kind of turns back. And he kind of skates to Provy. And all of a sudden, those guys start looking around. And they turn and they go the other way.
Picking up the loose change. Right?
And we are just dying on the bench because they saw Simmer. And he's right. There were like three guys coming. And so Provy's just like, oh boy, like, you
keep
know,
the flies
what
away.
Am I going to do? And Simmer just sees it and cuts back and then everyone just whoop, they go the other way.
He came back and almost stood there like
he was basically like, I dare you.
Yeah.
And then all three guys just loop.
For anybody who doesn't believe in the power of accountability, right? It's like perfect example right there.
He was, it's like he said, like Provy, that's another thing I love about your game is, You have it all. I'm not trying to pump your tires here. So.
Yeah.
but seriously, you do. I believe you're going to be a Norris Trophy winner, but you have it all. But I love the fact that when they're, you don't go out of your way, but if you see a guy with his head down or see a guy, you hit him and they're always clean. But I love that about your game because a lot of people, you know, try to take the physicality out of the game. I hate that. I don't think that that's something they should do, but you're a clean player. You never play dirty, but you've had some really big hits.
I mean, for me, it's all about an opportunity, you know, and all about, you know, making reads, you know, whatever happens on the ice, I always, you know, kind of either skating with the puck or without the puck, I always scan and, you know, see what's going on and what could happen and what's going to happen kind of thing. So, of course, when I have an opportunity, when I'm angling the guy and, you know he's going to cut to the middle and you just lean this way, of course I'm going to take that, you know. If depends on what type of player it is, but, you know, whenever I can, you know, get a hit and, you know, lay someone out, of course I'm going to do that.
Yeah.
And not take yourself completely out of the play because it's more calculated than like Danny Gauthier, you know, a big hitter, but like he would literally pull himself right out of the play if he missed the guy, only got a piece of him. You got to be going the other way.
That's true.
I mean, it's more calculated.
It's honestly all about, like I said, what type of player is coming at you, how he's coming at you, what speed, what kind of, you know, if you have a good angle, then you're able to hit him. If you just, you know, it's never good to just run straight at the guy. One deke and you're gone.
Right. Yeah.
So, you know, when you know, if you have to use your stick to get the puck, you know, out of someone else's hand, you do that. If you can, you know, lay someone out, of course, that's definitely, it's definitely, you know, enjoyable and it's fun to do, but you know, it's not going to happen every time and only if the opportunity is right.
Yeah.
Riley, I remember thinking about big hits. Your first shift ever in NHL, you had a huge hit on Sean Hill.
Yeah.
At home.
I remember that.
Riley literally got his first shift. He jumped over, and I mean, it couldn't have worked out any
better. It was so
got
perfect.
Got wrapped around, and that Hill was a pretty big man.
Yeah, it was just perfect right off the bench. You know, D-man's, you know, come out of his right corner coming up, and I just hop over the bench. And, like, the angle was like perfect. You know what I mean? So I just like beelined it, full on sprint as hard as I possibly could. And he just skated right into me and just blew him up.
Oh, gosh.
Big hits, man. They're tough to get when you're not putting yourself, you know, actually doing them, you know, properly and not putting yourself out of position. I mean, I wasn't very mindful when I played. So, I mean, I wasn't like thinking about like the way you're thinking about it. You know what I mean? But, I was just trying to blow guys up. I was trying to get something going, but you could go 5-6 shifts without a big hit. You know what I mean? Yeah. And it's timing. There's an art to it. And, you know,
I think one of the best guys at timing, he's like a shark, is Zach Ronaldo.
Oh, Reno, yeah.
I mean, that guy can hit. And I mean, he just, he had a knack of I guess he scans.
He's like a predator. Tutu was like that as well.
Yoni Pikkanen didn't want him. He hit him in the American League lockout year. And from that day on, when we were with the Flyers, Yoni said, his tum-tum hurt. Because if we played Nashville, wherever Toots was playing, he wasn't playing. There was something wrong. What did he say? I got a fever in my belly or something. Because he didn't know exactly how to say what was wrong with him, you know? But he was a great guy. I love Yoni, but he would not play. He did not want to play against Jordan because he got laid out. I thought he was dead.
It keeps guys honest, you know? Reno and Toots and those guys, are that caliber of hitting were just, you know, dangerous, you know, because they're super explosive.
Yeah.
And
for sure.
It ended up being, you know, anticipating a breakout pass. A lot of times they would just hop on it and just blow up the winger.
Provy, one other thing I wanted to talk to you about. I'm sure people don't know about you is that what a dancer you are.
Dancer?
Yeah. I heard that you could be joining some kind of show because I've seen you on TikTok. And you have quite the moves, man.
Nah, I mean, it's all for good fun, but...
I don't know, man.
Imagine if you took a commitment from a hockey and golf into dancing, man. You'd be a superstar.
That's where I'm not very committed.
I don't know, man. You look pretty good. Don't worry. We don't have good editing people and stuff that are going to maybe throw one or two up there just to prove how good you are.
Let's stay away from that and focus on the things that I'm actually good at.
I've seen some of them, but you actually can dance. It's actually impressive. But anyway,
outside of the game, I mean, what keeps you ticking? I mean, you're a human being. You obviously have hobbies and other things you like to enjoy outside of just training. I mean, what keeps you? You going?
Away from hockey, you know, if I can spend time with family and friends, I love to do that. And I mean, I love, like I said, like Nasty said, I love basketball. You know, if I can go to a game, I would love to go anytime I can. I love playing any other sport, you know, away from, you know, the rink, just because, you know, I like staying active. I like competing. I don't know, movies, trips, you know, going anywhere is always, you know, fun.
Yep.
And just overall, if, like I said, if you do anything with friends and family and good company, you know, doesn't actually matter what you do as long as you, you know, have those people around you and just enjoy your time.
In your 4 years so far, who would you say is the funniest guy we've had or you've had there? Since you've been there,
lots. Raph,
Hazy's a funny guy.
Hazy, you know, my first year, Cuzzy was pretty funny.
Cuzzy, yeah.
Oh boy, yeah, you know? He's a beauty. He is one funny man. Yeah. What about pranksters? Any pranksters since I left? Anyway.
There's definitely some. I mean, those guys are definitely in that category too. But, you know, no one really, let's just say, plays pranks on me because sometimes I don't take them very well because I do like to prepare and go on the ice and without, you know, having a water cup under my helmet or something like that. But, you know, TK sometimes would tape your fighting strap or tape your sleeves up when you're trying to put a jersey on and you can't put your hand through it or something like that. But, yeah, there's guys that are always pranking someone here and there. So,
yeah, that was one of my favorite things, you know, being at the rink with the guys and chirping and, you know, just little things. I like to, for some reason, hide a lot and jump out and get people. But I guess when you're a little short guy, it's easy for me to hide, right? Yeah. Provy, another question I have for you is, I think I may know the answer to it, but what would you say is your biggest, so far, your biggest, like, thrill or best moment in NHL in these first 4 years?
I mean, The first goal is definitely up there. You know, it took me, I think, 21 games to get it. We were playing in Tampa at the end of the second period, face off on the right side, got the play kind of turned out that I kind of snuck back door, got a pass from Matt Reed and then shot it. And as soon as I saw the puck go in, I blacked out.
Yeah, of course, completely.
Blacked out. And then I only kind of remember when I was already back on the bench.
Right.
And then I think another one still from the same year was scoring two goals at home against Chicago.
Oh yeah, that's one right, in one shift.
That was definitely something, you know, something special and cool to, you know, be able to experience.
I remember you skating by Patrick Kane saying, "I'm the Showtime."
I'm the Showtime.
I'm just kidding.
Well, considering that, you know, my first game there didn't go so well.
Yeah, I was
really happy to kind of, you know, have a good game against them again at home, and you know, just kind of get 2 points back from them.
Right.
And then I guess against the Islanders, the double OT was definitely a cool experience. You know, as a kid, you always, you know, play outside or, you know, something you just always dream of, you know, big game, scoring an OT goal.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was definitely, a big game for us to force the game seven. And it was getting up there for time, you know, at the end of the second OT. And, you know, I kind of hopped on the bench. Hazy, you know, took the puck all the way down and then threw it up front. And then it came right to me and right, you know, whatever, top of the circles. And then, like I said, as soon as I, you know, shot it and as soon as I saw the puck go in, I was just, you know, really happy. I was like, game seven.
No, I couldn't imagine
all
that
feeling. All the boys were coming out. And I guess the final one would be this year against Montreal.
Those last two you said were what I was thinking.
I think, yeah, that's something another you know, as a kid dream of, you know,
yeah,
pulling
sure.
something. A move that, you know, you always, you know,
Bobby Orr asked.
Try, you know, in practices, but, you know, a lot of times it's really hard to do it during the game and, you know, being able to pull that off and, you know, score a goal and, you know, just, yeah, definitely up there.
You were flying. Look at a different dimension of speed.
I'll tell you, man, that play, I remember like it was yesterday. I was on the bench and Ian LaPerriere was beside me and, you know, you switch in. So anyway, Provy goes end-to-end. And when you went through your legs, I'm like, it almost looked like you weren't going to have room to cut in, you know, but you did. Mm-hmm. You leaned in. It goes in, and usually you know how hyper I am. I'm going nuts every goal. But I just turned and looked at Lappy, and I said, "That's what he does." And he hits me, and he's like kind of laughing. So I come off, and I can't wait to get to him. But I got to run in, turn the music on and everything, and he finally comes in, and you know, boys are going nuts. And I just kind of looked at him. He's just like kind of smirks, and like then I went over. I said, like, that might have been the sixth goal I've seen in a long time. But yeah, those are great answers. I should have thought of your first one, but I was thinking this year, Montreal, and then the overtime goal.
Honestly, before that goal, we started the OT. We're out there for like 30 seconds, maybe less, like 25, a little less than the usual shift. And then, you know, Yosi makes a change. And I was like, oh, goddamn. I was like, I was just so ready to get going. And then whatever, 12, maybe 15 seconds later, you know, there's another whistle, and then Yosi puts me right back on the ice.
Yeah.
And then we win the draw, go back, whatever, line up, and then go in. And then, whatever, after the game, he's like, yeah, I just want to give you a little breather.
Yeah, right. Of course. Like, worked out perfect. Thanks, Yosi.
That's great. I had a question for you, though. You get drafted in 2015, and shortly thereafter, your development camp. What were your initial thoughts of meeting this guy? Hyperactive, all over the map.
Oh,
what was going through your head?
No, just, you know, I was like, who is this guy? He's like, you know, all over the place, running around, joking. And, you know, I was from that point on, I was very particular in my gear still already at that time. Yeah. And I was like, I was a little shy. I was like, how do I, you know, bring it up to him that I kind of, you know, need this, that, you know, my skate sharpened this way and blah, blah, blah. And he's like, come on, just, I was like coming up to him, nervous, afraid to kind of ask. And he's like, come on, just spit it out, yeah. You know, just say it, you know. And then I kind of laid everything on him and he's like, holy shit, you kind of, you're high maintenance. Yeah, right. And then I was like, oh, now, I, yeah. You know, now I'm asking.
Labeled already.
Now I'm asking for too much, but no. You know, he's, you know, he's been a great help from day one. Yeah. And, you know, there wasn't a day by, you know, that went at the rink or anywhere on the road that, you know, we didn't laugh or, you know, had great time. So, you know,
yeah,
very lucky to have him, you know.
Absolutely.
And to meet him.
I appreciate that.
You know, 4 years ago, 5 years ago.
Yeah, we spent a lot of time together. Like I said, he was, especially his first year, you know, you weren't very loud. But most rookies aren't. They're kind of like, although some, but
you know, first year, you don't want to be too much. There's a lot of older guys and you kind of want to respect, you know, them and, you know, try to not to get in their face and, you know, also try to go about your own business and, kind of adjust, you know, it takes some guys less, some guys, you know, more, but, you know, it still took me probably 15 games to adjust, but so I didn't want to be like too much. And I guess in big crowds, I'm not overly overly outgoing, but when it's like this,
He was Provy, you know, he was quiet, but he talked to you when you talked to him, but I would always just try to get him going a little bit. Just kind of smile.
Well, you have a way of making people feel comfortable.
You know, we hit it off, I would say, pretty much right away. And he was, you know, I love the guys coming in, like I said already, you know, just that's one of the best parts about being on a team, even though obviously I didn't play, but having the guys come in, have the coffee, whatever, eat breakfast, and just talk and laugh. Those are the things I miss the most.
And
I know you feel the same way.
I spend more time in your office than on the ice.
I remember we used to... The first year after that lockout, when we won the cup with the Phantoms, my office was in between the Phantoms and the Flyers. Yeah, I was in the hallway.
I remember that.
So Ken Hitchcock used to come down from the gym and it would be Freddie Myers, Randy Jones, Jeff Carter, Mike Richards, RJ, and Taron Itomaki. In my office, it was just as small as the one you used to come sit in. Literally, guys like leaned up against each other, and Hitch would loop. What are you guys doing in there? He's with the Phantoms, you know. And I'm like, what a dick. I know who I'm with, man.
Yeah.
And you know, Karchi's going,
sure.
He's like, and he would just be like, I don't know, that room's not even big enough. Jesus, I don't know what you guys are doing, you know. And then he would just waddle, you know, walk off or whatever. But That's one of my favorite things, and Provy and I always talked a lot in the mornings and before the games when he wasn't getting prepared. But
especially my first few years, I lived in Jersey, and you know, most of the guys lived in Philly, and you know, I would be the first one, kind of one of the first guys in and one of the last guys out. So, and you know, even after I was done, you know, training, working out, recovering, I would just come and hang out, you know, in his office, just because I didn't want to go home.
Yeah.
You know, just, and, you know, kind of, you know, almost not be alone, but, you know, a lot of times some guys want to do their own thing.
Right.
And I was like, oh, we're just.
We talk about it, you know, everything,
equipment,
anything, just whatever. We just sit there, and next thing you know, it's 2 hours later.
Oh, I know.
He's like, oh, I guess I got to go eat some dinner.
Those moments.
I should probably go home.
Yeah. Right.
See my kids.
No, man, I appreciate you coming by and sharing some stories and insights about your career. It's been awesome. So
yeah, man.
Thank you so much for
it. Really appreciate it, buddy.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, man.